IVM.
You are listening to the Kahaaniya podcast. Kahaaniya is a series of open mic storytelling events organized by Tape a Tale. The stories you're about to hear were recorded live. They are told by the people who've lived them. This week, we feature two of these very special and unique tales. Our first story is by Krishna Iyer and is called A Moment of Faith.
It was the first lecture after the recess. We were all tired and still we had a lot of fun during the recess. We were sitting. Suddenly in the class speaker announcement, principal had started announcing about the vice captains, captains, head boy and head girl. And I had given the interview for the head boy. So I was anxious. My best friend was sitting with me. He held my hand. And right then, the principal announced the head boy of this year is Krishna Iyer. And I went berserk. It was like crazy. Like since fifth standard, I had this dream. I wanted to become the head boy. And now finally I am there. Jumping and dancing and all the fun. But probably life had not planned that for me. Cut to 2 months later. I half open my eye. I can look at the ceiling fan, which is higher than usual. Unlike my home. I have no memory. What is going on? I have no idea. I look around. It seems like a hospital. When I look to my right, I can see probably a heart monitor, a ventilator, the saline stand. I look towards the left. I have my parents and my relatives standing over there and smiling. I'm not able to understand what is going on. So I just look at my dad and he tells me, "You've woken up after a long time." I didn't get any sense. That didn't make sense to me. You have woken up after a long time. And he was like, 40 days you were under ventilation and today is when you woke up. And I was like, how? Why? Like, I don't even remember. Did I sleep at night? Did I sleep in the morning? What happened? He was like, you had an accident. I was trying to get up, but I felt like something's holding me back. I had no strength in my body. I was not able to get up. The day ended over there. The next day I decided, I'm going to walk my way to the restroom. I'm not letting these nurses help me and all that. I somehow stood up on my leg. My legs were shaky. It was very difficult. I somehow paved my path to the restroom. While I just thought this was the most miserable walk of my life with so much pain, I happened to look at myself in the mirror. A bald head. Bruised, brashed forehead, blackish blue in color maybe. A line of stitches over here with dry blood. While I thought that was really the worst thing to happen, is what I see next that crushed me from within. A half open eye that would never open for a normal vision. But when I look down, it'll look up. I was broken in that moment. I had no idea. Can you imagine that moment where tonight you went to sleep and tomorrow morning when you woke up, you just look like a sham or a disfigured face. It literally ate me from within. In there, in that moment, in the washroom itself, I almost broke down. I sobbed. Somehow I calmed myself down. I decided, fine, let's see what comes next. I turn around to open the door and thud. Misjudgment number one, the door hit my face. And that was bad, it hurt. But the miseries had just started that moment. The doctors told me, within 6 months your eyes should open, you'll be fine. 3 months passed, I had come home now, I was much more mobile. With every day I was discovering a new disability. Like you throw something towards me, I'm going to duck, I'm not going to catch it. You ask me to fetch something, it'll take me 2 minutes to decide the way I'm going to walk. Okay, fine. 6 months passed. That is when I started meeting people. And you know, people give you absolute reality check about what your life is. One was that kind who felt bad for me but never showed it. The other was that kind who felt so much pity for me that I started feeling sad for myself. And then the third kind came in. Who shouted into my face. Bro, tere saath to bahut bura hua hai na. Tu zindagi mein kya karega abhi? I was like, huh? Did I tell you that year was the time when I was in my 10th standard? And 10th standard obviously meant board exams, and board exams are a big deal. But I was in that stage of my life where people are constantly telling me, no, you don't do this. Maybe not. Don't give your exams for this year. It's just this year. Matter of 1 year. Don't try that. And from within, my confidence was breaking every day, a bit by bit. I was like, can I do it? Maybe not. I started questioning myself. And all along my life, I've been a very confident boy. But that day, I was literally questioning myself. So this one day, I was with Dad. I happened to ask him, Appa, what if I fail? My dad told me, what? What if you fail? Maximum you lose a year. Just imagine that part where you will not even try and you will fail. Are you going to regret that moment of your life that you never tried it and you failed? Or is this why they elected you as a head boy among 250 kids? Somewhere that did move me. That night I didn't sleep. I thought over it again and again, and there was just 1 month for the exams, and I decided, let's give the exam. I gave the exam. Cut to 3 months, date of result. A night before that, I hadn't slept. Anxious as hell. 1.5 liters of coffee, visiting the washroom for like every half an hour. My head is shunting between, what if you would have failed? I told you, don't give this exam. What's the big deal? You're going to be a loser now. I'm like, no, let's stay positive. I might clear. So, the next day, results, normally Mumbai University results show up on the site at around 11 in the morning. Since 10:30, I'm sitting in front of the PC. Really nervous. The clock is ticking there, but I can rather feel it in my heart. And that was difficult in that moment. Finally, it was 11. With sweaty hands, I entered all the details. I hit the enter button. But of course, Mumbai University, you don't get things at once. I did the same thing again. I tried for the second time. Entered the details, hit the enter button. Site jammed. Suddenly, my phone rang and I shuddered in that moment. What happened? People had started calling my friends and all. And no, it was not to ask about my scores. But what actually happened was, our batch results had come out. And the pass percentage was 99.99. Which meant one student failed. So they had written off that Krishna fail ho gaya rahega. Hum usse baat karenge. We are with you, bro. I just shut my phone down. Switched it off completely. I covered my head, my ears rather. In my head, I had to calm myself down because I had already started thinking, look, you shouldn't have given the exam. It was not a big deal. Now what are you going to do? I calmed myself down. I went and sat in front of the PC again. I entered all the details. Pressed enter. The page started loading. 20, 30, 50, 100. It was there. Results are out. Name, Krishna Iyer. Exam number, so and so. Remark, pass. I didn't jump, I didn't celebrate in that moment. I just went there and hugged my mom. Because that in real was a victory for me with myself, where I trusted myself. And that itself became the biggest thing for me in my life. Until date, I preserve that. The reason I bring this story today over here is that people are always going to tell you that you cannot do it. They will break your confidence. They will break your ego completely. But in that one moment, if you just trust yourself, maybe I will be an example. I'm standing here with my third story today.
That was Krishna Iyer. Stay tuned, because we have one more great story for you after this break.
Hi, I'm Amit Verma, the host of the weekly podcast, The Seen and the Unseen. In my show, I examine the seen effects and the unintended consequences of public policy and private action. I show how policies meant to help the poor often end up hurting the poor. I've done episodes so far on demonetization, GST, surgical strikes, immigration and MRP. And I will continue my forensic assault on the truth in the weeks to come.
Catch the show every Monday on the IVM Podcast app or any other podcasting app that you prefer. Or visit seenunseen.in for all the latest updates.
Welcome back to the Kahaaniya Podcast. The next story is by Diksha Dwivedi and is called My Father, a Kargil Hero.
Every year, I used to come across multiple articles on the heroes of the Kargil War. Not once did I read his name there. So, So I thought that I will write his story. His life was not a waste. And I'm going to tell his story, just like today, to you guys. So we were on a train, my mother, my sister and I. And we were going back from the most amazing, well-spent summer vacation. The summer vacation that we were supposed to spend with my father. My father, Major C.B. Dwivedi, Sena Medal. I remember very clearly that he came to pick us up, handsome as ever, in his green combats. What he forgot to tell us was that instead of the 2 months, we were getting 12 hours with him in Srinagar. Well, he wasn't allowed to spend more than that with us because Kargil war was declared and it was call for duty. That did not mean that we and our life stopped. We had our summer vacations, so we had to go for it. So we bid him goodbye and we went to West Bengal to our favorite cousin's place. Had a lot of fun. Now we were back on the train going back to Delhi after a very nice holidays that we had in West Bengal. And then we land at the Delhi railway station. And we find lots of our family members who've come to pick us up. And I'm like, why are they there? Like, they don't love us so much. Why so many family members who've come to pick us up? So obviously, there was something off. I could feel it in the air. So, long story cut short, with that blissful summer vacation, our life that we knew with the best father and the husband in the world was coming to an end. Well, we didn't know that. And I remember the night that we must have spent in the train sulking about the holidays that were getting over. He was breathing his last, saying, "I have two daughters," to a soldier. After that, he choked. So that was Daddy. 2nd July 1999, he sacrificed his life for the country. As an 8-year-old girl, I felt really guilty when I saw his news, like on the TV, and I saw his passport size photograph on the martyrs list. I mean, while we were spending vacations, he was fighting a war. And we didn't even realize it. That's when we realized that it wasn't the bad weather on the satellite phone. It was actually the war in the background. The f***ing war. I could not believe it. I felt really small. As an 8-year-old girl, I felt small. I was like, wow. While we were having fun in the rivers, meeting new people, going for weddings, he was at war? We didn't even realize it. So it has taken 18 long years to let my sense of pride completely take over the sense of loss, right? It is, I was thinking that, okay, fine. This is him. He got a glorious death, right? And I wanted to. That became the aim of my life. I want a glorious death. And I remember that. So I tried every field. I tried economics, I tried commerce, I tried acting, till I found my calling, which was a lot of things. But one day I got a call where I got the opportunity to write about the war that my father fought. And that was my chance. That was my chance to say sorry to him for being the cowardly 8-year-old daughter who could not face his martyred father's body. because I got scared when I saw him. There was white powder on his face when his body came. And I ran. I ran for my life. Because I could not see him. I did not hug him. I did not salute him. I did not say my goodbye to him. But I ran as an 8-year-old. And that's the weight I have been carrying for 18 years. So I was like, okay, I write about his war. Maybe that helps. So that's all that I want to say to him. That cowardly 8-year-old daughter is today a 26-year-old author and founder of a dream called Akkar Bakkar. And that's all because of you. So thank you.
That was the Kahaaniya podcast. If you have an amazing personal story that you want to share with the world, send in your stories to contact@tapeatale.com or on WhatsApp at 799-202-9939. If you want to dive into some more awesome stories, check us out on tapeatale.com as well as on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram and YouTube at tapeatale.
As you can see, we have a podcast listener in his natural habitat. Billions of years of evolution have led him to this point. He's on his way to work, and listening to podcasts makes his miserable day better. He will now head to work and use all his knowledge to communicate with other colleagues and possibly future mates. You can find more of his species on ivmpodcasts.com, your one-stop destination where you can check out all the coolest Indian podcasts. Happy listening.